How many folks remember a rotary poem? God, it's okay, dude. Cassette record. It's okay, folks. VCR? Yeah, kind of. Oh, man, 8-track. And I can remember with a cassette, and that's what we used to have. That was like the thing in the 80s to have in your car. I could hit that fast forward, rewind, get right to that perfect song. And it was, that's not 70. It was so new. It was cutting edge. 34 years. Can you find me? I did for a long time, and I finally gave them up. That was with the stonewashed jeans and a couple other things. And they're probably even them making a comeback. You know, there's no way I can fit in them. But these things used to be pretty common. Technology changes fast, though. Changes real fast. Then life changes just as fast. It's been said we're always in at least one of three seasons of life. Either we're at the beginning of something, middle of something, or we just got out of something. Sometimes the change is welcome. People getting engaged, they're showing baby pictures, they're having maybe a new job, new house, whatever it is. Sometimes the change isn't expected or wanted. Being laid off from work, a wreck, an illness, loved one becoming ill or sick. Natural disaster. Lord knows we found out more about that in the last 3 or 4 weeks. And how much it can disrupt your life. Unwanted changes in our lives can leave us confused, maybe angry, hurting. And even the strongest faith, sometimes we ask, why, God, did you let this happen? Ask that question more than once in my life, and we have to remember God didn't intend this life for us. Sin, rebellion, illness, death, it wasn't meant. When Adam and Eve first sinned, they released sin and suffering into this world. The Bible said, poor Satan's the author of sin, and it's the reason why we have afflictions. It's not that you do something and you get an illness. But it was released out in the world. Sometimes innocent people get caught up in things that they never had any involvement in. But God provides us a rescue through His Son, Jesus Christ. That's why Christ died on the cross, and that's why He rose from the dead. So this suffering will end in this world and not go on to the next. If we accept Jesus as our Savior. Because everyone's going to have an afterlife. No one truly dies. You die in this world and you're going to spend eternity in one of the two places, heaven or hell. Physical death is death of the body, but the spirit lives on. But if your spirit, your soul is separated from God for eternity, that is, it's lost forever. Hell, that's what makes it so awful. It's separation from God. Even in our lowest point, even in our deepest, darkest well of despair, we had God with us. Paul wrote about dealing with changes in 2 Corinthians. The church in Corinth helped produce some of the most powerful verses ever written in the New Testament. Always seemed to have a lot of drama going on though. Reason for this second letter came, there was a group of men calling themselves apostles, and they were false teachers. And they attacked Paul, his teachings, and his personal integrity, and it caused Paul a lot of stress for him. It was a big change for him. Normally he was welcomed in the church. Now, he had a lot of rough times in his ministry, but normally he was more welcome in his churches in Corinth because this was a church he founded. These weren't strangers. These were people that had turned against him. And if you have your Bibles, I'm going to get you to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. as I read this chapter, I started seeing Paul's teachings coming through. Help us deal with the changes that come in our lives. If you're here for a moment, you're going to have a change. And the changes over a lifetime, they can be hard to take. Jesus in John 16:33 told us the change is going to come. Change will come. There'll be trials. I'm paraphrasing. You may have peace in me. And there's going to be troubles and there's going to be sorrows. But take heart, for I have overcome the world. Verse 1 in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Therefore, since we have this ministry, as we receive mercy, we do not lose heart. When I'm facing a difficult change in my life, isn't it easy to get discouraged? If you have a doctor maybe telling you you got a such and such percentage chance of having this and this and this, you come in and maybe someone's telling you, well, we found somebody that can do this cheaper. We found a machine that can do this. Thank you for the 30 years. We don't need you anymore. Paul knew a lot about difficult changes. He was in prison 25% of the time in his ministry. He had been beaten and shipwrecked and deserted, had friends leave him, had people they thought loved him betray him. He never seemed to lose his heart for God. And when people read ministry in this verse, a lot of them look towards the pastor. When it comes to Christian life, there's one thing that God has commanded us to not outsource. And that's the work of the ministry. It's everybody's job to be a part of God's kingdom. Paul wrote about it in Ephesians chapter 4, that some folks, apostles, some folks, prophets, some folks, evangelists. Evangelists, just living the word of God. And I think in many ways, showing it more than telling it. Some of us pastors and teachers, but there's so many things that God can use us for. He wants to use all of us, whether your world's upside down or not.
How many people have felt that urging to help someone when your whole world's been torn apart?
Is it stronger then?
Than when everything's going okay.
It may be comforting
that person who's in the hospital bed or a family member sitting with them.
Text or call or visit.
You're not alone.
As a patient,
you might be noticing that nurse who's usually very sweet seems distant today
and asking about them. Many times the people in scrubs, but not many times, we go through the same ordeal as everybody else does. That person behind the counter at
Dollar General or Food Line or the Chinese restaurant, whatever, they deal with all the same struggles we do.
Maybe be just asking a friend to go fishing or hunting because you know they've been having a hard time. Just to get them away from where they're at right now.
Many times this is going to happen in God's time and not in ours. Verse 2, but we renounce the things hidden cause of shame, not walking in craftiness or adulterating the word of God, but by the manifestation of truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God.
Jesus said in John 15:19,
you're of
the world would love you as its own,
but because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world,
therefore the world hates you. The popular opinions, the social media, how are Christians portrayed? I saw something yesterday that it just shocked me. Political rally.
And it doesn't matter one side or the other. Whoever does it, it's despicable. This grown
woman got in the face of a
toddler because her dad
was voting for somebody else, he screamed at her.
I mean, screamed obscenities at her. And I don't care if it's blue against red against blue. Y'all,
a 10-year-old?
word, not of the world. Because it doesn't matter which side you're on, you can end up being used for bad things. Verses 3 and 4, even if our
gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, and in whose case
the God of this world
has blinded the minds of the unbelieving, so they might not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God.
This world preaches tolerance,
except to those who disagree.
Then there's no tolerance. Then it's, you shouldn't own property. You shouldn't do this. Free speech unless we don't agree with it.
And that runs on both sides. Both sides of the aisle.
50 years, our God's been forced
from classrooms, courthouses, so many public places.
Being replaced by metal detectors and bulletproof glass. Our children can tell you about foreign civilizations, foreign gods. What they learned about the God of Abraham,
Isaac, and Jacob.
People who make business
decisions are taken to court for their beliefs. But Jesus told us it would happen.
He did it. Matthew 10:22, and you will be hated by all on account of my name. But it is the one who is endured to the end
who will be saved.
Verses 5 and 6, for we do not preach ourselves,
but Christ Jesus is Lord.
And ourselves is your
bond servants for Jesus' sake. For God who said, light shall shine out of the darkness, is the one who
has shown in our hearts
to give the light of the knowledge and glory of God in the face of Christ.
You can't extinguish that light. It's in the hospitals, it is in the drug rehab centers. It's in the homeless centers. It's in the prisons. It's in North Korea. It's in Iran.
It's in small villages in Nigeria. They're
repeatedly raided and burned to the ground, but yet they build a town.
And that church is one of the first things
they build.
Jesus said in John 8:12,
when Jesus again spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me will not walk in the darkness, but have the light of life.
God didn't call us to blend in, but stand out.
We were getting a little song in there for the kids. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. I'm not going to do the dance or singing for you. We already have a, we're already missing a lot of folks. This will, several of y'all will get on up and walk on out.
But God asked, are we letting Jesus' light shine for us? Are we? Are we on a regular basis?
Are we in our house?
Are we in our businesses? Or are we doing it just a couple hours a week? You don't have to try harder.
Just trust more.
Trust that God will use you as you make yourself available for Him. Proverbs 3:5-6.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. All your ways acknowledge Him. He will make your paths straight. I had that texted to me when I first started ministry by Lisa's grandma.
And it is, that is one of my go-to
verses when I started out.
You don't have to be in the
spotlight because you already have the light.
Verses 7, 8, 9.
But we have this treasure in earthen vessels so that the surpassing greatness of the power will be of God, not of ourselves. We're afflicted in every way.
But not crushed.
Perplexed, but not despairing.
Persecuted, but not forsaken.
Struck down, but not destroyed.
Paul's talking about two things here.
Our physical bodies and our souls. Our bodies are earthy and earthy.
Lord knows.
They're sagging, and those of y'all that are young and just can go by with a few hours sleep or love to sleep all day, wonderful. Y'all hang on to it because there's going to come a point you're going to spend more time in bed, less time asleep.
You're going to have the
body, the mind of a 25-year-old.
But feel like
you went to high school with Moses. It's coming.
I've seen the frailty
of human my body from my time in the hospital, so many things happened to it. Body can't attack itself. Those who are dealing with autoimmune disorders know the pain.
They know the frustration.
Tiny microbes
killing you. But I've also seen the strength of the human soul.
That has the Holy Spirit inside it and let it work.
Then you hear some sick folks.
As a nurse, a business, and very sick people as a pastor, I've been saddened by the condition of the human bodies, but amazed by the strength of their spirits.
The bodies are sick and shut down.
Their souls shine.
Literally shine.
You have those special people that you go in to make feel better, and they make you feel better.
The beauty of the soul that has Jesus in it. Verse 10.
Always caring about in the body the dying of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may also be manifest in their body. Here's Paul. Paul's talking about the knowledge of Jesus as our Lord and Savior.
In verses 11 and 12, for we who live
are constantly being delivered over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death works in us, but life in you.
Living in the world
means things will change
and happen in our lives.
When Paul's talking about death in verse 12, we're all going to die one day in flesh.
No matter how
good care we take care, we take care of ourselves, living death occurs.
The one unchanged thing in this world is the key to everlasting salvation.
There's one thing that does not change. Jesus.
Hebrews 13:8. Jesus
is the same yesterday and today and forever.
Verses 13 and 14.
By having the Spirit, the same Spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believe, therefore I spoke. We also believe, therefore we also speak. Knowing that He who raised God, the Lord Jesus, will also raise us also with Jesus and present us with you.
Paul's
talking about faith. Faith in God. It's so hard to find faith and hang on to it.
In times of great change, our country is almost convulsive. Socially, spiritually,
morally,
with change. And while this is going on,
our personal lives,
none of the things
that happen in the life stop. Things break. People get sick. Job, school, class, whatever it is, keeps going on.
It can be disheartening. We look at the news and we look out there.
And we look at what's going on in our lives.
It's hard to have faith in that. Because we're tired. We're hurting.
Many of us confused.
2 Corinthians 12:9,
he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness.
Most gladly, therefore, I will
rather boast about my weaknesses, that the power of Christ may dwell in me.
God's our refuge. He's a refuge in trouble. Verses 15 and 16.
For all things are for your sake, so that the grace which is spreading to more and more people may cause the giving of things to abound to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart, but though our outer man is decaying, yet our inner man is being renewed day by day.
Our bodies get damaged. They get weaker. But these are not the bodies of eternity, but our season. Our season in this world right now. Ecclesiastes 12:7,
then the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to the God who made it.
Like the song says, death is swallowed up in victory. Again, I'm not going to say it.
Because
rhythm is something that I do not have.
But it's a promise that death is swallowed up.
Verses 17 and 18, for momentary light affliction
is producing in us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. While we look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen
are temporal, or temporary, but the things which are not
seen are eternal.
Things are going to change in our lives.
We can't stop it. Do you know someone who's dumb? They build walls like Jericho,
trying to keep it from changing.
Maybe they have wrestled with the trauma or whatever it is. They have one more comfort zone. They build around it. They don't want anything changing with it. You try and change it. You try and help them with healing. No, because it's livable.
Some people
build walls of stuff around people to keep others out. Change comes even through the walls. There'll be transitions from one season to another, one change to another, but our God's unchanging. He's forever. He is forever. Daniel
talked about
how he would have God of heaven set up a kingdom that would never be destroyed. Never. Jesus mentions in John, my kingdom is not of the world. God wants to be the main part of our lives. His person, family person, and everything else. How much does he want to love us and wants to be in our lives through all the changes good or bad? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Y'all, as we go to prayer, if there's a change or transition or struggle, let's lift it up. Let's lift it up to God in prayer. We all want God to answer our prayer, to answer our prayers when we believe in prayer. Sometimes, though, it's hard. It's hard to admit that you're having this problem, this struggle. Sometimes it's hard to even put it into words. It's okay, we have the Holy Spirit that will help us. The times we're living in are difficult, and we're trapped by our fear and our doubt. God's preparing us what I think are for end times. We may not see it, but I don't know how many more generations this world has got. How many times, instead of God limiting us, we limit him from helping in our lives? Stepping out on faith, that is hard. The truth is that the things we do for God should be outside our own ability and trusting in his supernatural ability. But we need him in. When we back away from him, dependence and trust in God, we're not living by faith. He wants us to trust and obey his word. He wants to help our courage to overcome our fear. Many times we think it's too big, it's too hard, and it's too difficult. Without God, yeah, it probably is. But he wants us to have trust and dependence. He'll let us know when it's time to walk out on faith. He'll let us know when it's time for us to act and time for us to be still. We don't need to be shaken. You broke through those walls in Jericho. You parted the sea. You raised the dead. Help us through our changes. Y'all, let's stand. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer. Father, all of us are dealing with something. There have been so much going on in this church family, Father, here lately. So much sickness, so much change coming. Father, lift up the folks who are going through this, and we all are in one degree or another. Father, be with us. Father, help us to be still when we need to be still. Help us to move when we're supposed to move. Help our courage to overcome our fear and our unbelief. And Father,
supposed to fill you all with us. Lead us in our thoughts. Lead us in our words, our things, our actions. Father, protect us from the enemy invading our thoughts. And Father, help us. Help us to be your lights out in this world. Father, help us as we go through these changes, go through these seasons. Help us to be willing to step out of our comfort zone, Father, according to your plans for our lives. In Jesus' name we pray.